Hello friends, I am going to tell first mnemonics for FHR decelerations after a quick review of normal FHR tracing. Then I will discuss variable decelerations and its type, how that will occur. And after that I describe certain concepts of abnormal FHR tracing associated with certain maternal conditions. Then I will tell the management of abnormal FHR tracing. Hope that it will definitely helps. And after this video, you will learn every aspect of abnormal FHR tracing except acceleration part of fetal heart rate. Here is a quick review of category wise fetal heart rate tracing patterns. The normal baseline is 110 to 160 beats per minute. Moderate variability in fetal heart rate is normal, with average amplitude of 6 to 25 beats per minute. Early decelerations and accelerations are also considered in category 1 because they are less risky and sometimes normal. Category 2 is an indeterminate pattern. Category 3 basically has no variability in fetal heart rate. And there are two types of recurrent decelerations. One is late and another one is variable. Sinusoidal pattern and bradycardia are also included in category 3 because of the high risk for a fetus. Early decelerations is seen in head compression. You can see that alphabet E and A present in both words. So by that you can remember it as well. Also, it can be normal FHR tracing, so don't worry about it. You can see that nadir matches with the peak of uterine contraction. Also, early deceleration takes greater than 30 seconds to reach nadir from the onset and from the nadir to the recovery. So both are same, and that's why it seems to be symmetrical and along with uterine contraction. Although early deceleration can be normal, but be alert in case of occiput posterior position because head compression occurs mostly in occiput posterior and transverse position. Compression occurs when the fetal head descends closer to the cervix, which contracts and causes narrowing of the fetal anterior fontanelle. The narrowed anterior fontanelle causes a transient alteration in cerebral blood flow and stimulates a vagal response, which slows the heart rate. Early decelerations are a benign physiologic finding as a part of vagal response and do not indicate fetal hypoxia, and therefore this deceleration do not require any intervention. Okay, let's move on to the late deceleration. You can see here as well that L and A alphabet are present in both late and placenta. So by that you can remember that late deceleration is seen in placental insufficiency. You can also see that time factor is same as in early deceleration, greater than 30 seconds. But the difference is late deceleration starts at the peak of uterine contraction. Why that's occurred, we will discuss later on after the next few slides. Okay, sinusoidal pattern is basically category 3 tracing and seen in fetal anemia due to severe fetal blood loss, and that's why it doesn't correlate with uterine contraction. And sinusoidal shape like wave is seen. So which are the conditions that cause fetal anemia? The most common one is vasa previa, which presents as bright red amniotic fluid. In this pattern there is no variability, and that's why it's considered as category 3. There is a smooth wave like oscillation like a rolling line with fixed amplitude of 5 to 15 per minute and frequency of 3 to 5 cycles per minute. This category 3 tracing is considered ominous because they are associated with severe fetal anemia, and because of that rapid fetal exsanguination and deterioration. That's why this condition requires urgent caesarean delivery. Fetal tachycardia means greater than 160 beats per minute. Common causes of fetal tachycardia include maternal infection, poorly controlled maternal hyperthyroidism, and certain medications such as terbutaline and also abruptio placenta. So you must be alert in chorioamnionitis and PPROM and manage them according to weeks of gestation. Okay, let's discuss fetal heart rate variability, a vertical portion of FHR tracing in the graph. Variability is the beat-to-beat fluctuation in the baseline. These fluctuations are irregular in amplitude and frequency and categorized based on amplitude change measured from peak to trough. As I have said, that normal variability is 6 to 25 beats per minute, but certain conditions are responsible for abnormalities in amplitude. Temporary fetal sleep, prematurity, fetal hypoxia, CNS depressants like narcotics, alcohol, and illicit drugs. In all these conditions, amplitude variability is absent or minimal, means less than 5 beats per minute. Opioids may decrease fetal heart rate variability due to fetal CNS depression, and exposed fetus also typically have decreased frequency of accelerations. These changes are temporary and normalize as the medication effect diminishes. You can see that common organ is affected in all these conditions is fetal brain. So by that it's easy to remember these abnormal conditions. Okay, let's focus on variable deceleration. Variable deceleration occurs when the fetal main blood vessels are affected. So basically it's an umbilical cord compression or prolapse. If you like these all tricks, then please tell me in the comment box. In the image, you can see that it occurs after the contraction and takes less than 30 seconds. There are two types of variable decelerations. One is intermittent and another one is recurrent. Variable decelerations are common after rupture of membranes and decrease in amniotic fluid volume, as they can result in umbilical cord compression and occlusion of the umbilical vessels, particularly during uterine contractions. Variable decelerations occur as a response to changes in pressure, as compression and occlusion of the umbilical vessels causes an increase in fetal systemic vascular resistance and also blood pressure, and a reflexive rapid decrease in fetal heart rate. The fetal heart rate rapidly returns to the baseline as the umbilical cord is decompressed. So basically, compression of the umbilical cord causing transient fetal hypertension that triggers a parasympathetic response and slows the heart rate. Definition of intermittent and recurrent decelerations is based on compressions to contraction ratio. Intermittent umbilical cord compression evidenced by variable decelerations with less than 50% of contractions, and it is typically well tolerated by the fetus and doesn't require any intervention. In contrast, recurrent decelerations is evidenced by umbilical cord compression with greater than 50% of contractions. It can result in a lack of fetal placental blood flow, which the fetus cannot tolerate, and causes hypoxemia and acidosis. First line management of recurrent variable decelerations is intrauterine resuscitation with maternal repositioning, such as left lateral or all fours, which may reduce cord compression and improve fetal placental blood flow. If the variable decelerations do not improve, an amnio infusion instillation of saline into the intrauterine cavity can be administered. An amnio infusion artificially creates more amniotic fluid, which can reduce umbilical cord compression and decreased variable decelerations on fetal heart rate monitoring. A cesarean delivery is indicated in patients with absent variability and recurrent variable decelerations, means category 3 tracing. Fetal scalp stimulation is performed to evaluate fetal acidosis in patients who have no accelerations on fetal heart rate monitoring. Fetal scalp stimulation is not performed in patients with decelerations, as it can exacerbate a parasympathetic response, resulting in a prolonged decelerations or fetal bradycardia. Let's discuss how certain maternal conditions affect the fetal heart rate tracing and also how do we manage. Let's move on to the next slide. Neonatal lupus due to maternal SLE. The most serious complication is fetal AV block, which develops at 18 to 24 weeks gestation. This likely occurs due to maternal autoantibodies binding to fetal cardiac cells and causing irreversible injury to the AV node. Without a normal AV conduction, the ventricular heart rate is around 50 to 80 beats per minute. That determines the baseline fetal heart rate, which appears as persistent fetal bradycardia, means less than 110 beats per minute. Uterine rupture may cause bradycardia, variable and late decelerations due to both fetal hypoxia and umbilical cord compression. Placental abruption and post-term pregnancies are associated with uteroplacental insufficiency and classically cause late, not variable, decelerations. In both cases, the placental surface area is decreased and has suboptimal function, causing transient fetal hypoxemia during uterine contractions. Umbilical cord prolapse is typically associated with an abrupt prolonged deceleration or bradycardia, as in prolapse the umbilical cord is compressed with no subsequent decompression. Epidural anesthesia may cause maternal hypotension with resulting fetal decelerations and loss of variability. The preterm gestation may be associated with an increased fetal heart rate baseline, reduced variability, and lower amplitude accelerations. Recurrent late decelerations means decelerations in greater than 50% of contractions are most likely due to uterine tachysystole, which is defined as greater than 5 contractions per 10 minutes. Uterine contractions temporarily interrupt intervillous blood flow. Excessively frequent contractions may cause fetal compromise as a result of decreased uteroplacental blood flow and inadequate recovery time for resumption of blood flow between contractions. Although uterine tachysystole can occur in spontaneous labor, there is an increased risk with induced or augmented labor with uterotonic agents. Uterine tachysystole is managed with supportive measures like lateral maternal repositioning and tocolysis, and also discontinuation of uterotonic agents. Oligohydroamnios, means amniotic fluid index less than 5 cm, may cause variable decelerations due to umbilical cord compressions, initially affecting the thin-walled umbilical vein and causing transient reflex rise in the fetal heart rate as the uterus contracts. But continued cord compression eventually occludes the thick-walled umbilical artery, causing a rapid increase in blood pressure and subsequent abrupt drop in fetal heart rate due to parasympathetic response. Okay, so how do we manage these fetal heart rate abnormalities? I am going to tell it category wise. For category 1, as previously said, no management is required, while category 3 is serious. So initial management includes maternal repositioning and certain other intrauterine resuscitative interventions like oxygen administration, IV fluids, and discontinuing uterotonics. All of that basically improve uteroplacental blood flow and fetal oxygenation. Operative vaginal delivery, such as vacuum assisted, is a management option for patients with category 3 with complete cervical dilation, means 10 cm. While patients remote from delivery, means not completely dilated cervix, and who do not improve with initial resuscitative measures, require an immediate caesarean delivery. Amnio infusion is indicated for category 3 tracing with recurrent variable decelerations, because amnio infusion may help relieve the umbilical cord compression. That's all about fetal heart rate tracing. Please tell me in the comment box anything you want. And if you like this video, then like, share, and subscribe. And as always, stay awesome!